This week on Vaticano, we introduce you to a woman who was abandoned and abused in her childhood, but with the help of her faith, was able to overcome adversity and build a full and happy life. Stay with us to witness how God can turn sorrow into joy. For this and more, Vaticano starts now.
Welcome to EWTN's Vaticano. This is Monsignor Anthony Figueredo, and I'm delighted to have a wonderful guest with me today, a faith-filled woman, Rhonda Sciortino. Welcome, Rhonda.
Thank you so much for having me. This is wonderful.
Now, Rhonda, you've written a number of books and succeed because of what you've been through is one of your most famous books, also Successful Survivors, all based on a concrete experience of life. Rhonda, what have you been through?
Oh my goodness. Well, the short version is that newness of motherhood wore off very quickly for my mother, and she left me with a neighbor and never came back. I was raised by a mentally ill man and an alcoholic and addicted woman, both atheists, in a little place the size of a garage, maybe like a shack, that didn't have working plumbing, and we didn't have a lot to eat. We always had alcohol and cigarettes and sometimes drugs.
As a young child growing up.
Right. This was it was a wild, abusive, very chaotic upbringing. But God had a plan through it all. Had his hand on me throughout poverty, abuse, a period of homelessness. And so I was able to emancipate from the child welfare system. I was a ward of the court through all those years when I was 16. And so I've since had just an amazing life. And that's really what I love to talk about, is how God uses those adversities.
Yeah, but Rhonda, you know, situations like these, they can either crush you, you know, they can lead people to drugs, to alcohol, even to suicide, or they can become the cornerstone on which the entire edifice is built, as we hear in the psalm and as Jesus himself says. What has that experience been for you?
Well, it has been, I won't say that it wasn't a difficult journey. It was a very difficult journey as I was going through all that. But when I was maybe 7 or 8, I spent a very short period of time with a set of Christian foster parents, and they took me to church. In fact, they actually got in trouble for taking me to church. It was against the rules at that time. And so I was removed from their home and placed back into the abusive environment after they took me to church. But the seed was planted. I was introduced to Jesus. Fast forward, a teacher in high school was an amazing Christian woman. It was a public high school. She didn't talk about her faith. She didn't proselytize. But I didn't realize that people didn't make eye contact with me until she did. I was always dirty. You know, we didn't have a shower bath. I would go months and months and months without being cleaned up. So I was dirty, didn't own a toothbrush until I was 13 years old. You know, just like a filthy little animal. And so normally people would sort of look and look away very quickly. And then I met this teacher and found that she treated me exactly the same way she treated every other kid in her classroom. She knew that I was a ward of the court. It was in my school file. And so she asked me to stay after class one day, and she shared with me that her children had been kidnapped, and that they'd been away from her for, I think it was that time, it was maybe a year and a half. And she was so worried that if and when she would be reunited with them, would they want to be with her? And so she approached me and she asked me if my mother were to show up and she wanted to reunite, would I receive her?
And what was your response to that?
Oh, yes, absolutely. Oh. I would love that. It never happened.
Even a mother who had been so bad to you? Is that possible?
We always want our mother, right? So my answer was yes. But what she gave to me, Monsignor Figueredo, is that I didn't understand at the time. I was 14. And in asking my opinion, she gave me dignity. In making eye contact with me, she gave me dignity. I hadn't had that before. No one had ever asked me. And people don't ask foster kids, oh, what's your favorite subject in school? What do you like to eat for dinner? No one cares about those things when you're a child who's been thrown away. And so she gave that to me. And so I wanted to assure her, oh, her children will receive her and she'll get them back. And I said, but how do you come to work every day? No one would ever know. And she said, oh, it's my faith. And I said, oh, you go to church? She said, yes, that's part of it. So she shared with me the kind of church that she went to, and I looked in the phone book and found that kind of church, and I went and I wanted to be baptized. And so they said no, but I would have to take this class. So I hitchhiked. I got rides every single week and I went to the class. And
so you're coming into the Catholic Church. Was that another experience in your life?
That was actually Missouri Synod Lutheran. I had no idea there were so many different, flavors of Christianity at that time.
How has the Catholic faith made a difference in your life?
Oh, my goodness. Well, it's I don't even know where to begin. There's a richness, there's a depth there that I could spend a lifetime trying to mine it and not fully grasp and understand it.
In a few moments, we'll be back with more on Vaticano. More on Vaticano begins now.
One of your favorite passages of scripture, we all have a favorite passage, but yours is Romans 8:28. Those who love God, He works all things for our good. But someone watching this and they're going through some great tragedy in their life, a death, an abuse, human trafficking, all things, Rhonda?
Absolutely.
Tell me. Convince me.
Ah, oh my goodness. Well, you may be sorry that you asked me because I'll do my best. I feel like that God allowed the suffering of my childhood, abuse, and it was abuse that made no sense. You know, I was disciplined with a skillet of hot oil when I was 4 years old.
Hot oil?
For talking too much. And now I get paid to talk. I travel all over and I think, oh, you know, this is only God could do this. So I believe that what we go through develops in us character traits and coping mechanisms that wind up making us stronger, more courageous, more resilient, more resourceful, more persistent. All the character traits that we need in order to find and fulfill His good plans for our lives. And so I think about, okay, my childhood, and everybody's been through something, right? Everybody has had pain. You don't go through this life and not have something, right? And so whatever it is, we can mine the lessons. So for me, abandonment by my mother really formed in me as a very young child that nobody's gonna come rescue me.
This is the message of the cross. In the Catholic faith, we say that the cross, God did not will, God does not will abuse, but He uses it for a greater glory. Rhonda, That is what you've really experienced in your life. Rhonda, you've also written a couple of books on prayer and the power of prayer. One of those books is The Prayer That Covers All, and it's particularly Our Father. Now, you were going through a difficult moment in your life, and prayer had a great influence.
Oh, indeed. So my husband was very ill. He was not expected to make it through this particular illness. My daughter was going through a terrible time in her life, my only child. And so I was at this place where, you know, you've prayed every prayer. It's that gut-wrenching, knees on the ground prayer. And when you can pray no more, and it's really just crying out to God, that's where I was. And so I was led to the only prayer that Jesus taught.
The Our Father.
So I thought, I don't know what else to say. Because at a certain point, when we're praying and we're praying and we're praying, pretty soon it's begging. And I think, there's no faith in begging. The faith is in, like Jesus said in, is it Mark 11:24 or thereabouts, that whatever we ask for, believing that we would receive in his name, we'll have it.
Good. It's prophetic. God answers prayers already. You know, some of the great saints tell us, thank God already, because he's going to fulfill his promises.
Indeed. So I found myself, I'm on my knees, and now I'm begging and pleading and crying, and I'm thinking, wait a minute, this isn't faith. I'm not asking anything in faith. I'm whining. I'm just whining and complaining now, and I don't think God's going to respond to that. I need to just step back for a second, get back to basics, And look at this, the only prayer that Jesus taught. And so as I'm reading this prayer and I'm trying to incorporate it with faith, I had to sort of break it down. I have sometimes, I think, sort of a childlike mind, a childlike faith. And that's where I wrote this book. I thought, I'm going to share what I've been through and what was helpful for me.
There's another book you wrote, Keys to Answered Prayer, because very often it seems that God isn't answering our prayers, mm-hmm. but he really is. So what are the keys to answered prayer, the title of another one of your books?
Oh, indeed. The Holy Scripture gives us so many tools, and it would be impossible to name them all. But I tried sort of just combing through and mining some of the nuggets. All right. So the scripture tells us that we have not because we ask not. So one of the keys is ask.
It's ask and you will receive.
Ask. And sometimes with boldness, sometimes we want to say, oh, I better not. Oh, I don't deserve it. Oh, my goodness. Oh, that's too much. Oh, maybe God doesn't really intend for that. No, ask.
Absolutely. He's generous. He wants to give. He gave his son. What else?
Indeed.
Would he spare?
He says that he delights in our prosperity. The another key is, are we asking selfishly? Are we asking so that we can have our fourth pair of boots that are maybe more stylish than last year's pair of boots? Are we asking for something for someone else? Are we asking for something that's for the greater good? What are we really asking? What's our motive? That's another key. So we have to approach this with sort of some introspection too.
Mm, like a discernment. Pope Francis often talks about discernment, and I know one of your strong themes is don't clutter up your life.
Indeed, absolutely. So we have to cleanse our heart. When Jesus said, ask for whatever you're going to ask for, in the same breath, he said, and forgive. Right? If you have something against somebody, forgive. So right, we have to unclutter our lives with those the negativity that we harbor, anger, bitterness, resentment, jealousy, all of those things just clutter our
life.
Have
you forgiven your parents for what they did to you?
Absolutely.
How is that possible to forgive someone who's been so bad to you?
Oh my goodness. Well, you know, first of all, I think they probably did the best they could at the time, based on what they knew and what they were capable of. And really, I got everything I needed from them. See, you know, when in God's word, when he says, I think it's Ephesians 2:10, I'm terrible at quoting, chapter and verse, but the substance of it is we're God's masterpiece. He created us for a specific work, right? So he perfectly creates this recipe. So I like to think of, okay, if God's creating a recipe, that's you. So he takes the best DNA of your mother's line and the best DNA of your father's line, puts that together, maybe a little sense of humor, maybe a little common sense, maybe, you know, all the different things that you're gonna need, right? And then he arranges for all the experiences. So he knew when he created me, before he formed me in my mother's womb, even though I don't know that woman, it's okay, because he already arranged for those foster parents and that teacher and the man who gave me my first job, and that helped me to emancipate out, launched a 40-year career of protecting and defending the good people and organizations that take care of abused kids. He arranged for me to meet my husband. He arranged all these things.
He's an artist. God is an artist.
Oh. It's amazing.
It reminds me a little bit of what Blessed John Henry Newman says. He says, God has not created us for naught. He's created every single human person for a service, for a mission. It leads me on to another book that has just come out, Acts of Kindness, 101 Ways to Make Our World a Better Place. I think it's a topic that we need very much today. So very much Pope Francis as well, he talks about simple words like please, thank you, sorry. What are some of these acts of kindness?
Oh, for me personally, one of the most significant things that we can do is to look people in the eyes. I think human dignity is so incredibly important. And in our culture, in this world today, it's so devalued. A lot of people don't even think of dignity, right? If we talk about, you know, what's the most important thing? What are the most significant things? So many people talk about things, right? Their handbags, their clothes, where they live, their address. Is it in the good part of town? Is it in the wrong part of town? You know, these things. And I think, oh my goodness, If we could just get back to dignity, integrity, the character that is sort of foundational to these acts of kindness. And then when we give them away to others, what are we doing? We're not only giving kindness to someone who may actually desperately need it, and we never know. What someone's going through. But also we're modeling for everybody within our influence how to do it. It takes no time, it costs no money. So I think it's eye contact, it's smiling, it is, as you mentioned, please and thank you, and really just meaning it.
Thanks for watching. Stick around for more on Vaticano. Welcome back. You're watching Vaticano.
It's so much the foundation of the Christian moral life and Catholic moral teaching, for example, on abortion, on care of the elderly, euthanasia, that we're all created in the image and likeness of God. There's an exciting new initiative, Rhonda, that you are really launching. It's an ecumenical initiative, and you've already launched successful businesses to help particularly children and families. Love is Action Community. Exciting. Tell me all about that.
Oh, all right. So I'm so excited about Love is Action Community Initiative. The Catholic Church in particular has been out doing works of mercy, right, since the beginning, right? And so this is not a new thing. The idea of it, though, is to bring together all faiths, people of all faiths, and people with no faith, frankly, to come together in communities, in local communities, and to provide specifically defined ways that everybody in the community can help the most vulnerable in the community.
What would some of those vulnerable people be? For example, a local parish in Iowa, small town.
Right. Kids and families. In every community, there are children who are either orphaned or spiritually orphaned. So many parents addicted, right? They're either gone entirely or they're vacant. They're emotionally not engaged.
The lack of a father now in so many families, fatherless.
Indeed. So, you know, there are just so many kids in particular. I mean, that's my heart, but there are lots of people in communities who are suffering. And there are people in a lot of communities who are not necessarily suffering, but they're alone, they're disconnected. All right, so the idea of this initiative is that we have child welfare organizations, social services organizations, we have the church, local business, national, large business, but everybody coming together and with specific ways that people can connect. So what does that do? It goes to the point of eradicating social isolation, connecting people with others. So people who are unbelievers are just as welcome in this initiative, at this table, if you will, as people from the faith community. And so rather than evangelizing them with scripture and telling them, you must believe as we believe. No. We give them an opportunity to be attracted to the work of love.
It's like charity is the calling card and it opens us out then to Jesus.
Indeed.
That's the point. So a local church, it could begin in a local church, but with a single person who's passionate. You want Christ-filled disciples who
Absolutely.
Are the backbone of this initiative.
Yes.
And how would it work concretely then? How are you going to set this up?
Okay, so the church in Iowa you mentioned, all right? So if it's a small church and there's just one person who says, oh my goodness, I want to be the champion of this. I want to do this, all right? So the organization that I chair is Successful Survivors Foundation. And so this person could go online to successfulsurvivors.org and they will be able to download a blueprint, if you will. And so the blueprint provides a various ministry opportunities that are already proven, safe, in place in other places. There are names and phone numbers and contact information for people who can help with those particular things. So if it's a small congregation, maybe they choose just one thing, one place to start, right? And then go out into their community and engage everyone. So for example, you want a concrete example. So one concrete example would be, let's say a hairdresser who says, I can't give money, I don't have time, but what could I do? And we say, one morning a month, could you fix the hair of, kids and teenage girls in foster care? Could you fix the hair of foster parents?
So everyone's involved.
Everyone. Yeah.
Everyone
the car
can
mechanic can change the oil of the car. Right? So then... there's a way for everybody. The quadriplegic says, what could I do? Oh, You'll be on the prayer team.
Absolutely.
Maybe you'll be the head of the prayer team.
Rhonda, one of your favorite expressions, dream with Jesus. I see your vision. One of my favorite passages, without a vision, the people perish. Do you have a vision? Why dream with Jesus?
Oh, well, the best strategic planning from a business standpoint, right? The best strategic planning is with Jesus because he's the best business consultant, right? And so as an individual, the best envisioning of what God wants from us, wants us to do, finding and fulfilling his plan, who better to do that with than with Jesus? So I love the notion of just dreaming with Jesus because I can come up with, oh my goodness, a million different things that are good to do and that should be done might not be God's calling on my life.
Rhonda, you are a living example that God is not overcome by evil, but overcomes evil with good. It's been a delight having you on our show today. Please pray for us as we pray for your initiative, Love is Action Community. Thank you very much, Rhonda Sciortino.
Thank you for having me.